Harken back to the old days when you were only 23. If you were anything like me, you were probably pretty clueless, and you almost definitely hadn't performed at the Kennedy Center with a musical group you created when you were only 18. An ensemble which the Washington Post has called the premier ragtime orchestra in America. How's this even possible? I drove down to Annapolis to try to find out how Andrew Greene has accomplished so much at such a tender age.
Debbie Greene. I'm the proud mother of Andrew Greene, the founder and director of the Peacherine Ragtime Society Orchestra. Andrew has always been passionate about music. He came from a music household. I'm the music director at a church. He's always had music in his house from the time he was born. He started as a classically trained pianist. At about age 4 and 5, he was clunking away notes, and by the time he was 11 and 12, he was giving piano concerts to raise money for charities. He connected with a great pianist and mentor, Getha Klignot, who was his piano teacher. She found that he was getting a little frustrated with the classics, so as a reward, she introduced him to Scott Joplin.
Nice, sweet Scott Joplin number. 1, 2, 3.
She told him he could take a little break from the classics, and he's been on break ever since. And this has always been his ideal. When he gets an idea, he runs with it. He was a student at Broadneck High School in Annapolis, Maryland. He was a string bass player. His orchestra teacher gave him the option of creating a small ragtime orchestra. That was the start of his orchestra career, and then when he went to the University of Maryland, he founded a group there. Through hard work and dedication, he found venues for them to play, and they've been off and running.
By the time I had entered college, I had had about 150 arrangements, and I started to gather musicians. On February 21st, 2010, the Peacherine Ragtime Orchestra, as it was originally called, had its first rehearsal in the basement of a dorm hall at the University of Maryland. We practiced for months, finally debuting publicly on May 2nd, 2010. Slowly but surely, our group gained momentum. By the end of the year, we had screened our first silent movie, Buster Keaton in Cops. And within 2 years, we were traveling out of state to perform. In 2012, we were invited out to the Levoy Theater in New Jersey to celebrate their reopening after being dark since 1974. I was invited in 2013 to guest conduct the South Dakota Symphony Chamber Orchestra using Peacherine scores. In 2014, we underwent a small rebranding, changing our name to the Peacherine Ragtime Society Orchestra. We expanded our programming, added a brand new website, and redid our logo. Our big break came in August of 2014, when Peacherine and I were invited to play on the Kennedy Center's Millennium Stage in Washington, D.C. The concert was a hit. The Washington Post and the Kennedy Center jointly titled us the premier American ragtime ensemble.
Andrew told me about the special show that I got to see last night at the Maryland Hall for the Creative Arts.
Last night, Peacherine performed our Halloween show, where we show three silent comedies with live musical accompaniment and then play Halloween-themed ragtime pieces.
We're here in the new orchestra pit, bringing back to life the days gone by of the early American cinema. So tonight we'll be transported back to see three of the silent comedy's greats, Buster Keaton, Harold Lloyd, and the immortal Charlie Chaplin. In order to have this fully immersive experience, we need to have a 1920s audience. Back then, if they saw something they liked on the screen, they would clap and cheer. I think you guys can do a little better than that. The audience would clap and cheer. If the audience saw the beautiful damsel, the girl, they would awe. Not like a come on, a sweet awe. There we go. If they saw the villain on screen, they would hiss. And finally, if the audience saw something funny, they would laugh.
Ghosts and ghouls, we pull out rare Halloween-themed music most audiences have never even heard of. And this is one of them, Creepy Creeps, a goblin dance from 1902. And the result is just fascinating. You see all of these films on the screen with the orchestra playing the live music. You have these orchestrations that were written as stocks for any group in America or around the world to play. The combination of both of these just makes a magical night. One of the main reasons I got into ragtime was because I was able to feel all of this sheer joy in the music. To me, this is this lost treasure that America seems to have forgotten even existed. And now they're bringing it alive for audiences where they'll come up and have a huge smile on their face because most of this music they've either heard about from their grandfather or great-grandmother, but they haven't heard it themselves, and it's a true revelation for all who hear. Certainly it's one thing to just see a movie with music. You could go to the local theater today and do that. But to have this live element where you have 12 people playing and you also have your drummer doing all of these sound effects.
I'm Eric. Kluinski. I'm the percussionist. I have a unique role in this music. Not only do I accompany the pieces with drum set and bells, but I also make a lot of different sound effects. It is extremely fun, sometimes a little bit stressful, but it's always a great experience to be a part of what's happening on the screen.
Do you guys watch the movie? How do you know when to?
I do a mixture of running a stopwatch and watching the movie at the same time. So I have a cue sheet with the times of the events that are supposed to happen with my percussion instruments, and I cross-reference the ticker with what's happening in the movie to make it line up.
I'm John Hasse. I'm curator of American music at the Smithsonian.
I first met Andrew in the summer of 2013. He applied to do an internship with me, and he worked with me for 9 months on all sorts of projects dealing with American music. He researched our collections, organized photographs and information about musical instruments, and he was absolutely invaluable. He did a terrific job.
Andrew's penchant for scholarly research about the music that he so dearly loves is a large part of his mission as an orchestra leader.
As part of all of this research and work that Peacherine does, we also collect original 78 RPM record discs. And we use these to listen and hear how the musicians played the music back in the 19-teens, the aughts, and the 20s, so that way we can then bring this authentic style back to life in our performances. And Peacherine has about 700 of these records. We put them on our turntable, and then we digitize all of the records so that way we've got modern MP3s appropriate for Halloween. Skeleton Jangle by the original Dixieland Jazz Band. We treasure them and use them to help bring America's music back to life. Behind me, you'll see the collection of about 2,000 original theater orchestrations from the early 1900s. Each of these theater orchestrations are complete for the 11 and piano ensemble that Peacherine uses. And they're a great gateway into America's past. So as part of the Peacherine collection, we have all of these different folios for orchestra.
Each folio is written for one instrument only. Here are the corresponding sheets from two folios, one for violin and one for cornet.
To now have these orchestrations and perform them and bring them alive for audiences is a huge thrill for me.
I'm Nina El-Hassan and I play clarinet. I started playing with Peacherine Ragtime Orchestra last year. My friend Corey plays trombone with the group, and he was the one I think that recommended me when another clarinetist couldn't do the gig. It's just really fun music. Andrew's super well organized, runs rehearsals really quickly, makes it fun.
My name's Avery Boddy. I am a trumpet player, but with the Peacherine Ragtime Orchestra, I play cornet. I met Andrew a couple of years ago, and having never played in a ragtime orchestra, I was a little reluctant to do it. I normally play classical music, but this has turned out to be a really fun gig.
My name is Livia Amoruso, and I'm a violinist. Andrew Greene emailed me saying, I have this ragtime orchestra, I'm looking for musicians, and I've been playing with them for 3.5 years now. I primarily play classical music, but I'm also really into jazz. Ragtime was the predecessor to jazz music. I really like playing other genres just so I can expand my horizons. It's really fun for me.
Among the many composers that Peacherine and I both love to play, of course, Scott Joplin, George M. Cohan, Irving Berlin, Sousa, the big ones that everyone knows, I like to rediscover all of these composers that seem to be glossed over. A personal favorite is Mel B. Kaufman, who was a traveling underwear salesman who also composed music on the side. And his music is simply delightful. And the way you'll know his music is through Looney Tunes cartoons of the 1930s, 40s, and 50s. If you have Sylvester the Cat on screen, which is chasing around Tweety Bird, this is his composition, Meow, from 1918. And it's really incredible that this composer, who people have heard in scores for cartoons and newsreels and old movies, is now forgotten by the American public. And so we love to play his works along with many others. Next year, in 2015, Peacherine and I are actually going to be recording an album of Kaufman's music. It'll be the first album solely dedicated to Kaufman's music, and I think it'll be a true revelation for the ragtime community to hear all of his works.
What is More Candy about?
It's about picking up chicks. That's why they have the pretty girl on the cover.
So candy's not candy, it's...
It's eye candy. More candy. It's more delight for the eyes. Musicians would write tunes for dancing, so the one step was a popular dance, along with the bunny hop, the grizzly bear, the foxtrot was a popular dance, and Mel Kaufman specialized in one steps as well as foxtrots. And you know, you have John Philip Sousa, the March King, so there were marches for marching to and dancing to. The biggest one of his was the Washington Post in 1889. But all of these were dance forms that the American public craved.
At the end of the show, I got to meet one of Andrew's friends, who, like Andrew, is a wunderkind of early 20th century popular music.
My name is Adam Swanson. I have just relocated to Baltimore, and I'm now studying musicology at the Peabody Conservatory. And I've been playing ragtime music for nearly 10 or 12 years. I've known Andrew for 3 or 4, if not more. I was just so thrilled to get to hear his orchestra live again tonight. And Andrew is one of only a very, very small handful of people in the country that plays this kind of music with an orchestra. I just applaud his efforts. It was wonderful. He made excellent choices of films. The audience obviously enjoyed it. I was really happy to see such a big turnout, too, because with this really old music, you rarely see that. I have played as pianist with his orchestra on 2 occasions.
Do you think you might play with Andrew again?
He's mentioned we might do some things in the spring, so I hope so.
Now Peacherine is about to enter our 5th year, and we're looking to become even bigger and better. I've been incredibly proud of my musicians who have served with me, keeping America's musical traditions alive. And we're looking towards a bright future, preserving and performing the syncopated stylings of this bygone era.
I can't in good conscience end this movie without clearing up one particularly vexing issue. Andrew, what's up with those gloves?
Well, when we're accompanying silent movies, we do it the traditional old-fashioned way where we get the theater in the dark and the musicians all have stand lights. And to help them see, because it's often difficult to see some hands flapping in pure darkness, I wear white gloves. Some people call it the Mickey Mouse effect. They can see me conducting and they know how to follow me when we're playing the show. Otherwise, we've had shows where I don't have the gloves and it's been tricky and sometimes we get a little error once in a while, but the gloves help with all of that.